All right, we're starting at the weighted average costing method. Our calculation will be different from FIFO and LIFO to calculate cost of goods sold and ending inventory. One thing that I need to mention here, there's something that we call it cost of goods available for sale. What that means is it's the cost of all inventory that you had during the period before considering any units that you sold out. So in other words, cost of goods available for sale, it's what you had at the beginning of the period plus all the purchases you did during the period without subtracting any cost of goods sold. So if you think about it, the total of cost of goods available for sale, it's actually the total of cost of goods sold plus the cost of goods, cost of ending inventory. Because the cost of goods available for sale, it's like a basket that has that's full with inventory, and then that's everything we have. It's there, and then we sold out some of what we have inside the box. Okay, so it's gone. It's out of the box, and then the leftover inside the box is going to be the ending inventory. It's what we still have there in the box. Okay, so before selling it, it used to be there in the box. So everything we had there, it's called cost of goods available for sale. Now, all those three different methods, FIFO, LIFO, weighted average, it's actually deciding how do you want to split that cost of goods available for sale. And then be careful, we talk about the cost of the goods, not the number of units. We talk about the cost of those units, okay? So those three different calculation methods decides how you want to split that cost of goods available for sale between cost of goods sold and cost of goods ending inventory. If you use FIFO, you will give less to the cost of goods sold and more to the leftover, which is the ending inventory. But if you do LIFO, you will give more to the cost of goods sold and less to the ending inventory. But again, the total will always be the same, either you do FIFO or LIFO or weighted average, the total of cost of goods sold plus ending inventory, okay? So what will change is how you wanna split it between cost of goods sold and ending inventory. So always, when you add cost of goods sold plus ending inventory, you will come with the same, you will come up with the same total, okay? All right, so weighted average, it's average, but it's not just adding the two costs and divide by two, or three costs and then divide by three, because that will give the same weight to each one. But that's not the case. We're gonna give more weight to the cost that has more quantity than the other cost that has less quantity. That's why we call it weighted average, not just average. So how do we do that? Step by step, we need to find out what is our average cost per unit. Every time you have a purchase, you need to calculate your average again, because you wanna be ready to calculate your cost of goods sold whenever you have a sale after that, because you're gonna use that cost per unit for calculating your cost of goods sold. It's not like FIFO and LIFO, you go either in order or in backwards. No, you gotta use the average of everything you had so far for your cost of goods sold. So let's start with the ending inventory. And then on August 5th, we purchased four units, $360 each. So we need to find out the average as of August 5th. We had two units as well as the four units we purchased on the 4th. The unit cost $350 for the two units and then $360. And then I'm gonna do that. I will find out the average for those units, and I'm gonna do the I will use that space here in the bottom for all the calculations. Okay, so we will do 350 multiplied by 2, put that in parentheses, and then add to that the 360. Just trying to fix that plus sign. Anyway, it made it worse than before. That's fine. 360 multiplied by 4. And we're going to divide by the number of units we have, which is 6. So that will give us the weighted average. Okay, so it's not just 350 plus 360 divided by 2. We need to give more weight to the 360 than the weight we're going to give to the 350, because we have 4 units for the 360 and only 2 units for the 350. So that's how your formula should look like. All right. So after you do your math, you will get 356.67. That will be your average cost per unit. Okay. And so I will just go ahead and just mention what is my average cost per unit. And then your total cost is 2,140. Okay, which is pretty much what we have here in the numerator before dividing by 6. All right, now I have a sale on August 15. How many units did we sell? We sold out 4 units. What is my cost per unit? Well, we just have to go back and find out what average we came up with for all the units we have in stock so far. It's the average for all of them combined. So I just have to put 356.67, and then when you multiply, you get 1,427. Okay, so the cost of those 4 units is 1,427, and by the way, the ending inventory for those 6 units is 2,140, and then on August 15, after we sold out the 4 units, my leftover will be only 2 units, and the unit cost for each one of them is the same amount we have. It's the average, which is 356.67, and then once you multiply, your ending inventory will be 713. Okay, so I would say that would be $713. And then there is also a different way in how to find out the your ending balance for the ending inventory. Instead of multiplying 2 by 356.67, what we can do is subtract 2,140 minus 1,427. Because where did the 1,427 come from? It came from the 2,140. Okay, we took some of it and sold it out. So 713, it's just the leftover of the 2,140 after selling 1,427 of inventory, right? So either way, you can check your work by doing your calculation in two different ways, okay? 2 multiplied by 356.67, you get 713, or 2,140 minus 1,427. Okay, now what is my ending inventory on August 26? We had a purchase for 12 units, all right? So I just want to carry over the 2 from the August 15, as well as the purchase I did on August 26. The cost per unit for the 2 units, the average cost per unit is 356.67. The cost per unit for the 12 units that I purchased on August 26 is 380. And then we're going to calculate the average again, because every time you have a new purchase, you have to recalculate your average. And that's with the perpetual inventory system. And I'm going to use that space here at the bottom for calculations, and I'm gonna do pretty much the same what I did here. So that will be the 2 units multiplied by 356.67 plus 12 units multiplied by 380, and then divide by the total units I have, which is going to be 14, and that will give me an average of 376.64. Okay, so 376.64, and then if you multiply 376.64 by the 14 units, which is pretty much what we have here in the numerator, it's also the same thing, you will get 5,273. All right. And then the next step is to look at August 31st. August 31st, we sold out 10 units. And the cost per unit is just the average that we just calculated. It's 376.64. If you multiply that by 10 units, your total amount would be 3,766.4. Okay, so your ending inventory will be, I used to have 14, we sold out 10, so now we have only 4 units at the end of the period, and then you multiply that by the same average that we calculated. I did not purchase anything on August 31st, so I do not have to adjust the average cost that I calculated on August 26th. I'm just going to carry over the same average. Okay, so you multiply that by the 4 units, you get 1,507. So over here, the 10 units we sold out, I'm just going to show the cost of goods sold very quick. That would be 3,766.4. And the same day, those 4 units, the ending inventory, the cost of ending inventory for those is 1,507. So weighted average, I think, from my experience, that's where a lot of students, they make mistakes, and because they forget that, some of them, they forget that they have to adjust the average every time they have a new purchase. They have to recalculate the average every time they have a new purchase. And that only happens with the perpetual inventory system. When we talk about the periodic, you will notice that it's a little bit easier, less calculation, and probably less complicated as well, if you want to. Okay? And then once you get those costs for cost of goods sold calculated, then you can go ahead and record a journal entry. Those are the ones we learned from the previous chapter.